Masses and fronts, not one front. Hopefully.
Not what?
I'll tell you later. Well, the air mass, the definition, will become obvious after a first introduction. Once it became possible to draw weather maps, it also was, became also quite evident that the large scale changes in weather conditions all over the world is related to pressure systems and to their movements, to pressure systems variations. So the first big step towards a prognosis, towards a forecast, a weather forecast, yeah, was the recognition of the significance of the formation and the movements of pressure systems. It tests lows and highs, depressions and anticyclones, or cyclones and anticyclones. And the next step forward towards this direction, the forecast, was the discovery of the fronts, which means of the nature of the frontal zones, which we will define later on what the frontal zone is, but anyway, the nature of the different masses of airs and the boundaries which divide two different masses of airs and which are called fronts. And also, quite important was this development of a theory about the polar front, which is at least in the northern hemisphere, since the southern hemisphere is much sparse populated, much less populated. Well, the significance of the polar front in relation to all depressions which are generated there. I say that once more. There's a theory which says that, not actually a theory, they started as a theory, but now it's established, all the major depressions which generate all the violent met phenomena in the northern hemisphere, they all start at the polar front, where the polar air meets the warmer southern air. And this fact, this procedure, led to a classification of air masses, and with the frontal surfaces as boundaries between them. That concludes the introduction part. Well, formation of air masses. The definition: air mass. An air mass is quite different to an air mist. Is a big body of air, homogeneous, uniform in properties. In which properties could a body of air be considered as uniform?
Temperature.
Right. And humidity.
Humidity,
temperature,
well, pressure.
Maybe mostly pressure. Well, pressure. Mainly temperature and humidity. But the point is that, according to the definition, I'm not sure if I mentioned that. Horizontally uniform is the point, because if we don't mention the horizontal dimension. Well, then, why is it necessary to say to define it as the air mass as a horizontally uniform layer?
The differences in pressure.
Temperature and pressure due to the vertical gradient. And the humidity, of course, the humidity
of air masses
is zero at the troposphere. Well, almost zero. And yes, this was the definition. This one. And why, if we pose a theoretical question, normally the lapse of temperature between, or the variation of temperature between the equator, the tropical regions, and the poles should be gradual, but it is not gradual. It is not gradual because of the source regions, of the source regions, which we'll see in a while. In order that the mass of air, the mass of air becomes uniform in properties, there must something, it must stay a long time, many days, weeks, possibly, over a region of the surface of the earth, over an area which is in itself uniform in properties. Such areas are?
Sea.
Well, the sea, if it is uniform in temperature, but
deserts.
The deserts, correct. The deserts are quite uniform in property and in humidity. And the poles?
The poles,
right. So the main sources for the formation of air masses, the main ones, are the poles and the tropical, as it is stated here, the subtropical belts of high pressures. I will come to this in a minute. Why high pressures? And the extended continental highs, which are rather uniform, especially barometric highs, especially in winter. So I repeat once more: an air mass takes its characteristics, develops its rather. Obtains its characteristics by staying stagnant, stationary, for a long period of time, in a uniform, in a uniform or over a uniform in terms of temperature and the moisture characteristics over a uniform area of the earth. And which areas of the earth are more favorable? Coming now. To this point, which are more favorable for a big body of air to stay there for a long time? An area with a high pressure or with a low pressure? We must remember what is the difference in terms of winds. Where is the wind stronger? In barometric lows or in barometric highs?
Lows.
Probably in barometric lows. So that's why the more favorable areas for an air mass to form are the areas with the extended barometric highs. And as it stays, after it stays for a period of time, nothing is permanent on Earth, there is always some goes, some wind blows, and the air mass is transported to another area. So, in such a mechanism, air masses of different properties come to close proximity with a boundary which divides or which unites them, if you like. That boundary is the frontal surface. So, the air masses of different properties are brought together in close proximity. And we mentioned the source region. So let's go to the classification of air masses, which is done with through two criteriums. First, the source of the area where the air masses was created, and second, the way over which it traveled. Whether it was over land or over sea, right? So, it matters where it was formed, the air mass, and then over which kind of earth surface, water or land, it travels. That distinction is very important. Why should that be important? It matters whether an air mass travels until reaching, until coming to close proximity with a different air mass. But anyway, in few words, an air mass is important. What makes an importance is whether an air mass traveled over sea or over land. Why? Pardon? Exactly, because of the humidity.
Over the sea.
Over the sea, an air mass that traveled over the sea is moister, has greater humidity, relative humidity, if you like. And after these two criteria, we come to the classification, which should be here, for this. So, according to the sources, we have polar and tropical air, which is subdivided according to whether it traveled over land or over sea to polar maritime or to continental, to polar maritime, to polar continental, tropical maritime, Tango Mike and Tango Charlie, respectively. That's all about the classifications. And as I mentioned at least twice, the boundary which unites or which divides two air masses of different properties is called frontal surface, the boundary frontal surface, which frontal surface actually extends from the ground or from the surface, from sea or ground, whatever, from the surface of the earth until some level, beyond which it is impossible to distinguish the properties, to distinguish which air mass should be characterized as warm and which as cold, because they merge at this level, they merge and they're not very distinct characteristics. This frontal surface, this we could call it also a transition region, could be of various thickness from some thousands of feet, several thousand feet to several miles, the thickness of the frontal surface. And where exactly the frontal surface intersects the surface of the earth, that intersection is called the front. So front, when we say front, it refers absolutely, it refers definitely to the surface. That's why fronts are always shown, they appear in surface charts, in the synoptic charts. So a front cannot be high at a high level, since the, of course, the frontal surface, but where it intersects the surface of the earth, there is the front. The front is a line, in other words. The frontal surface is not vertical, it is sloped. For instance, if this is the ground, if it were without that O, would be Grund in Luxembourg, yeah? Well, frontal surface is not like that, so I wipe it, and it's not like that because cold air, as denser than the warm air, is heavier. And since it is heavier, it tends to form a wedge, sphina, a wedge, a, how's that called, chalk, or a wedge anyway, into, underneath the warm air. So if, so if this is the cold air, it should be like that. We'll see later what a cold, what is the distinction between a cold and a warm front is, but in few words, as it is, I suppose, clearly shown by this drawing, a cold front is a situation where the cold air replaces the warm air. It pushes the warm air, is pushed and replaced by the cold air. So it's a vertical cross section, of course. Eh? It is a vertical cross section, this thing here. And it is the frontal surface. In this vertical cross section, where's the front? The front.
Exactly. The frontal surface.
Exactly. This is the front. Because it is a vertical cross section, otherwise, it would be a line. Exactly. The slope of a warm frontal surface is less steep than the front of a cold frontal surface. And actually, it is two or three times less steep.
Pardon? The cold one, you said.
The cold one is like that.
Yes.
The warm one is like that. This slope is 2%. I think so. Yes.
Very sharp.
Yeah, yeah. 2% or more. And in case of a warm front, it is 1% or less.
And I this think is it should be more like the warm front.
The warm is what?
The warm frontal surface.
No, the frontal,
yeah. Is like more like curved.
No, no, the cold front is more curved. But in these drawings, we didn't take. I didn't take into account the friction.
Geology is long time ago.
Right, you're taking into account the friction in the friction layer within the first 2,000 feet from the surface. I will come to this in a minute. Well, this is a situation of a rather invisible atmosphere. Cold air, warm air. And this is... This is a warm front, this is a cold front. As we see, and as it should be expected, always the cold air forms that wedge underneath the warm air. Either the cold is the front is a cold one or a warm one. And there's the stationary or the quasi stationary. Where is that?
Here.
Yeah. Front which does not move, actually does not move particularly, which means neither the cold air replaces the warm, or vice versa.
I'm sorry, quasi,
yes.
Stands
quasi-stationary.
Almost.
Pardon?
Almost.
Yeah, almost. Quasi means, yes.
Almost.
Means
in Italian,
light,
exactly.
Light.
Exactly.
Light.
In Italian language, means almost.
I thought it means like, or not.
Almost.
Anyway.
But isn't that what they call occluded front?
Occluded front.
Is something else?
No, occluded front is when a cold front is chases
yeah.
a warm front and catches it and removes all the hot air from the surface. So the hot air goes up. That is within my second lesson, the occlusion. The occlusion. Well, let me keep some. Yes, we have given definitions. These symbols refer to, as it is written, on weather maps, on surface synoptic maps. And of course, that means that in case of this symbolization, cold air comes from, if it is orientated, if the chart is, the drawing is orientated, comes from low to up, from south to north. This is the direction of the front. In this case, again, this is the direction.
The direction of the front.
And the quasi-stationary does not move, well, practically does not move at all. It can be visible.
Sorry, the quasi-stationary is cold or what?
The quasi-stationary is
what? A mixture.
From this side, but it is a very good question. From this side, we have the warm air, probably, because the warm air is protruded.
Yeah.
Yes, well, it is a mixture in the sense of movement, but it is a front, but it doesn't move. It is a front which is stationary. A stationary front. Here is again the warm air, which is protruded into the well, graphically protruded.
You actually have two fronts confronting each other and stationary.
Right.
They're not moving.
And the cold air is.
How come the warm doesn't sort of ooze through the cold and then go up?
No one penetrates. The other. But what sense you mean? There are two masses of air, one warmer or one colder than the other. But the front between them does not move. Well, all laws of meteorology are definitely laws of physics. Yeah. All of them, laws of physics. But what makes the difference? I was keeping this point for the epilogue. But would be pardon? Yeah. The point, the difference between math and physics, is that the scale. There are two differences. One important difference is that math, the scale in meteorology is enormous, enormous scale. And the second one is that, unlike in a laboratory situation, we cannot intervene.
Uncontrollable.
Unless artificial rain, perhaps. Yes. Well, in minor things, perhaps. Yeah, thank you. And in this, I just reproduced on the transparency what I have already drawn there. There is a reason why I put that quotations here.
It
is three-dimensional. Three-dimensional. I took a rectangular, stereo rectangular, and from this side, the cold air is coming towards the warm air. But the quotes are because we can never draw in three dimensions on a two-dimensional chart, board. Like a joke. Pardon?
The difference of humidity between the two.
The difference humidity. Of humidity? Between the two. Well, it varies. There are cold, humid masses, yeah. Air masses, or warm humid masses. It varies very much. This should be that simplified. Pardon?
The temperature here in Luxembourg is, warm, and the humidity is high.
Yeah.
What have you had this last week? What's happened now with the weather?
Well, this is a good question. But in order to answer you, I would have a very thorough net of information.
No, but I mean, would we suggest that there's been a warm maritime front?
Yes. I don't know. It should be.
Tropical maritime.
Probably
a polar continental.
I don't know. I'm not in a position to answer you, sorry.
It's rather difficult. Not all the direction of the winds.
Can you guess?
Over the area.
Listen, no, I can't. Not all the variations come from fronts. Some of them are local phenomena.
Yeah, but we've had a situation of high pressures, easterly winds, hot, dry, and now we've got much cooler, wet.
No, I didn't see the Met reporter. Anyway, it could be anything from a front attack. To
a Luxembourg special.
To a Luxembourg special. So the polar front. The polar front is, as I mentioned roughly before, is the polar frontal surface is what distinguishes, what divides the cold polar air from the tropical. Air which is warmer and which originates in the tropical regions, and it is very important to know the position of that front. Front always refers to surface, correct? Front always refers to surface. But if we know the position of the front and if we know the general slope, we can, calculate the average position at other levels, at higher levels. Anyway, the most important issue is to know its position, because there is where the most violent, the most vigorous depressions of the northern hemisphere are generated. Right, and then come to the last part, which is wind and pressure change through the passing of a front. In other
front
words,
or front.
Pardon?
Front or frontal? Because front is a line on the earth.
Right, right. Well, let's consider the overhead projection, as your planes, the overhead projection. Anyway, when passing from a zone from a frontal surfaces, well, it's the same. Since time is rather pushing, let's have this with the explanations, of course. I remind you, these are called isobars, or contours, yes, lines of same barometric pressure. And contours, yes. It is presupposed that the movement of, in all cases, the movement is from west to east. Everything moves from west to east. In three cases, both.
Three cases.
and another thing, that fronts I represented by straight lines without making those teeth, because it is immaterial, it is irrespective of whether a front in each case is a cold one or a warm one, which means these things happen however the front is a cold or a front one. This is the irrespective, correct. These are the direction, the velocities of the wind, which is not exactly parallel to the isobars due to the Coriolis effect. Anyway, yes, to that effect. So this chart shows the possible positions, possible positions of the isobars at any front, cold or warm, of the northern hemisphere. I repeat, of the northern hemisphere. That's why I put, in each case, I put the barometric highs to the south, the barometric lows to the north, because in the northern hemisphere, due to the Coriolis effect, in every depression, wind turns anti-clockwise, like California, anti-clockwise. Clockwise, wind is blowing in the southern hemisphere. Well, since air moves from west to east, since wind moves from west to east, roughly parallel to the isobars, there must be. And the wind, of course, pushes the front. In this case, the wind pushes the front. It's understandable or not? The front is a boundary. It is pushed by the wind. There must be a set of contours, a set of isobars, of contours, not exactly vertical to the front, of course, but they must give a wind component which pushes the front, definitely. The wind could not blow like that and the front, so that the front couldn't move the other way. So, this set of isobars, of contours of isobars, runs through the front. What is to be observed? Well, several things, three of them. First, there is this bend of the contours, this bend of isobars. This always happens when the isobars cross or are crossed. 3 minutes I do have. I didn't count time, sorry.
3 minutes.
Well, when the isobars cross the front, they always bend to the side of the load. That will be obvious in a while. And we can observe another thing. When a front passes, the wind is looking upwards, then looking a bit. Is turned a bit to the right, the wind direction. Say again, as a front passes from west to east, wind from this direction, turns to the right. Right? That happens whatever the front is, a cold or a warm one. So, at the passage or through a front, with the passage of a front from a place, wind veers. You know the word veers. To veer, veer at the sign gears.
You mean the heading of the wind is always towards the equator?
Well, the direction of the wind is towards
equator.
Towards the low pressure, definitely towards the low.
Which comes from the southern parts, of course.
Which one?
Southern parts.
No, the wind is
coming from westerly.
The surface wind, which is affected by Coriolis effect and by the friction, is almost, well, it is not parallel, but it is at an angle with the isobars. And of course, this is another oversimplification. The isobars are taken as straight lines. Well, we must simplify things to demonstrate.
What are the isobars?
Lines of same barometric pressure at a time.
Okay.
Well, as the front passes, the wind veers, and the opposite verb is to back. To back means to turn anticlockwise.
The positive.
Well, in a positive
direction,
idea, yes, sense, right. And the third conclusion is what comes out of this intentional straight line end point. The point is a fixed one, a fixed point, a fixed place on the earth. As the front moves from west to east, all points of the straight section of the line BC, if you like, of Bravo-Charlie line, pass over the point alpha. The point alpha is fixed. Yeah? Fixed. Geographical fixed point. Which is the same as the alpha runs through all points of BC, but from here to there. And if you observe the relative positions from rather the points on the line BC, but from C to B, you will see that the points go from the isobars of high pressure to isobars of low pressure, which means that over the point alpha, as the front proceeds from west to east, the pressure first lowers, falls, and after the passage of the front, the pressure starts to increase. So the three, I believe I will complete it in my next lesson, but let me repeat the three basic conclusions. With the passage of any front, wind veers, the isobars bend sharply exactly at the position of the front, and the pressure first falls, and after the passage of the front, it rises. Well, let me finish the other time. Thank you very much for your attention.